supervisor and then our campaign for sheriff, because I owe you that. What has occurred over the last 4 months has been a complete and utter nightmare, and an ordeal that's been well reported on in the press and in the media. I've never told my story. My wife just recently printed an opinion piece in the San Francisco Chronicle on Friday, April 6th. Until that was published, there's never been any telling of any story. There had been some friends, like Vernon Melgar, who I believe wrote a very insightful op-ed piece in the Bay Guardian. But mostly who's been driving the conversation and the whole narrative has been the media. And I have to tell you, and I have to confess, I've never been more scared and more insecure and felt more vulnerable in all of my life than what occurred over the last 4 months. And what was torturing me, because I wasn't able to really get a handle on the tsunami of bad press and the level of negativity and social disgrace and everything that was coming along with this ordeal, was how do I speak with friends and people who put so much into me and our effort, and that has been really eating at me for quite some time. I called Anaconda. I've spoken to others over the course of the last few months, and I really appreciate the people that are here that have reached out to me and to my wife and my family to be supportive, and I thank you for that. But I want you to know that I made a terrible mistake on December 31st. An argument that that occurred between my wife and I in our car over the subject of she taking our son and she taking an extended trip to Venezuela, which was not an unfamiliar discussion we had. The quarrel was heated and intense, and I tried to de-escalate it by asking my wife and putting my hand underneath her arm when she was unharnessing her son from his booster seat. He'll be 3 on Saturday. And in that exchange, she got a bruise on her arm. She was upset. She confided to a neighbor the following morning. This is a person who she had believed was an attorney, and she'd been talking with her about the things that were on her mind. I didn't know about any of this with regard to that level of detail. The next thing I know, on January 4th, 4 days later, the authorities have been contacted, not with the consent of my wife, not with any consent of her or anybody on behalf of her. And from there, everything became a runaway train of innuendo and rumor. Nothing that I expected, nothing that we were prepared to even deal with. And that sort of took the lead in painting the events. I was prepared for trial, and I really wanted to go to trial. But after our jury consultants made it very clear that we were just not going to get a fair trial, that it was so evidently clear that with over 200 questioners returned from prospective juror pool, with such a high pollution rate, they were polluted because of the bias that had been engendered based on the preponderance of media, that I had to make a call that I really did not want to make, and that is that it was time to put this behind me. And that's exactly what I did and what I thought I did. So I pleaded to a low-level misdemeanor. It was at such a level that it would not inhibit me from being sheriff. It would not inhibit me from possessing a weapon, which is part of being sheriff. And it was already understood that with the other charges that were leveraged and then dismissed, that that's what would happen, that by taking this low-level misdemeanor. And I thought we were putting this behind us. And then a week later, I was informed by the mayor in a very brief discussion
which would have lasted no more than 60 seconds if I hadn't asked him a number of questions. As soon as I enter his office, he is giving me an ultimatum to resign or face suspension. That would have been the end of the story. I told the mayor, or asked the mayor, I should say. I said, "Mr. Mayor, how did you arrive at this decision?" And he said, "Well, you were thinking about it over the weekend with the city attorney during your research, but he said, you've never heard my story. You've never heard my wife's story. This is the second or third time at that point where I said, I'd like to tell you our story." But it was evident he'd already made his decision. I asked him about due process. There was no due process. And to be suspended without pay is something that I know as an elected and someday longtime advocate working with City Hall for many years, that this didn't feel right, it didn't smell right, and it, in my opinion, undermined the parameters of what we know to be just and fair in City Hall. And so when I even offered him the phone number of my wife, encouraging him to call Ileana to get her own independent account of details, that wasn't followed through. It was important to me to tell the story, even to those, especially who are rendering a decision that would affect, I think, not just my family's life, my life, but just really the city the way it is. This is why I'm fighting. I've taken responsibility for an action I feel terribly, terribly sorry for. I am sorry for any embarrassment or shame that has come to any of you and to the people of San Francisco who stood by me, because I want you to know that I take this position with great seriousness, that I want you to hear it from me firsthand of how important this is to me, that you know how important you are to me. I haven't talked with any other group tonight, I mean any group ever. The Milk Club is my first. So this is my baby step. So it is important that I try to be as thorough as I possibly can. It has practically destroyed me as a human in every sense of the word. I am not the man I used to be. And I can only hope when I emerge from this, I become a better person, father, husband, and I believe I also would be a brilliant advocate for the causes that matter to you and for the issues that concern us. And the reason why we fought so hard to be in the sheriff's office to begin with, it gives me a rare perspective that I can say few, I think, would have in this position. And I don't want to discount that, because the pain that so many of us have felt in this process is not pain to be dismissed, but hopefully one that can be used, I think, to the benefit and asset of improving our lives, improving the lives and of the criminal justice system. So, I will end there. I'm more than happy to answer any questions as possible. There was so much misinformation put out by the press as it concerns what happened with my wife and I, that it's just absolutely a campaign of shock and awe. And I was in shock, and so was Ileana for a long, long time. She's in Venezuela with our son, which has been well reported. I haven't seen or talked with my wife since January 13th. And that has been so incredibly painful that people, I want them to know that it has been always her determination as well as mine to repair and rebuild and be together. In her op-ed, her opinion piece, which I learned what the rest of the world learned of it. And I was approached by a media scrum as I was coming out of the courthouse. The only thing that came to mind as I read it that morning was, this is a love letter.
Yeah.
Because I hadn't had any contact with my wife in 4 months, practically. And to do that, and then trying to also manage the level of vilification has just been mind-boggling to try to turn this into where I can, I think, speak with you with the level of clarity and sincerity that I hope, you know, resonates with you. So, I never said domestic violence is a private family matter. How that got painted in the very first few days of this incident, that became a branding, did not come from me. There was no imprisonment of my wife for 18 hours, as the news reported by hearsay comments. The plea deal that I pled to was on the basis of the fact that when I and Ileana were driving at 11:45 a.m. on December 31st on our way to lunch, because we were having this intense quarrel, I decided to not go to lunch against her wishes. We're going to Delfina's Pizza, California, and Fillmore. They don't take reservations, and I was afraid we were going to be arguing in public while waiting for reservations. So I made a decision to turn the car around and to not go to lunch, and that upset her. That is part of the charge that I pled to. That's the basis of it. It is a nonviolent, low-level misdemeanor. Mm-hmm. And it allows me to still be sheriff. But what is happening now on this question of dissuasion is completely false. And I am determined to fight this with everything there is, because I will not be broken or destroyed based on these kind of allegations. So I look forward to our day in front of the Ethics Commission, or in front of the Board of Supervisors, or what have you, so that they can at least exhibit their burden of proof as well as we can do this. I would never do something like that. And that is important, why I'm hanging in there. This is uncomfortable and inconvenient that this may feel. I owe it to not just myself and my family, but to all of you, because it didn't happen. And if they can do this to me, if they can remove me with suspension without pay, and they can remove me based on the fact that I haven't curried the level of friendship or the level of relationships that I should have so that it could inoculate me for moments like this, then I'm sorry, but that isn't me. I've never been part of a machine. I've never been part of an infrastructure that could come to my rescue when I have screwed up in the way that I screwed up. And I'm fully exposed and fully vulnerable and transparent in front of everybody. I have been splayed out of the map through the press, through the chronicle, dissected in ways that at any one time, you can imagine how I would just want to walk away and just be away and never return again. And trust me, there have been moments where I have felt just that level of devastation. So I'm trying to muster the energy to speak to you, whether you agree, disagree, or indifferent. If you feel that in something, whatever the case is, I should be or shouldn't be in sheriff, on the very basic level, you should hear from me. And then you can at least say that you've heard at least some part of the story that's never been told. So I'll stop here and be more than happy to answer any questions.